Let's start with the fundamental client-server model, where you have a server exposing an API, the client sends a request, gets a response back. But what exactly is an API and how do you scale your service? Hi, I'm Piyush, and in today's video, we are going to discuss all things about API. So let's get started. Now, in the first video of this cloud fundamental series, we have seen how a data from the application layer flows through all the levels and forms the data packet. We have seen how the data packet flows through multiple autonomous systems or the network segments and finally reaches the server. We have also seen a fundamental TCP handshake mechanism. Now, in today's video, we're going to discuss APIs in general. We're going to use everything that we have learned so far to understand more about APIs. Now, let's look at the client-server model that we are familiar with. Now, we are going to discuss APIs over HTTP. But before that, what exactly is this API? Say you have written a piece of code and you're running the process in a particular server and you want to expose that to be used by others as well. So you will expose that as an API or an application programming interface. And this exposed API is called as a service, which will be used by other clients. Now, APIs that are exposed over HTTP are identified using an HTTP URL that has the server base URL to identify the server uniquely and the API name in the path. Now, in the previous video, we have seen that for clients to communicate with the server, the clients need the public IP of the server. To get that, the client's HTTP client will communicate with the DNS resolver to get the IP address. Now, once it has the IP address, this HTTP client can establish a TCP connection with the server and then use HTTP to, do something with the service exposed. Now, before we understand APIs in more detail, let's understand how DNS resolvers work. Now, let's say you have a client that wants to find the IP of api.abc.com. So it sends this information as a request to a recursive DNS resolver, which is provided by your ISP. And this DNS resolver will try to find in its cache if it has this information. If it doesn't, it will send this request to a root DNS server. Now, the root DNS server has information of all top-level domain. And in this case, it is a .com top-level domain. So it sends back the server details of the .com top-level domain. The DNS resolver will now send the same request to a top-level DNS server, which is .com in this case. And now the top-level domain servers or the top-level DNS server has information of all authoritative DNS servers. So when you register a particular domain, in this case, abc.com, the information about your authoritative DNS server is submitted to top-level DNS servers. Now, once the DNS resolver gets information about the authoritative DNS server, in this case, abc.com, it will fire the request to the authoritative DNS server and will finally get the IP address of api.abc.com. The DNS resolver finally provides the IP address to the client and caches it for future usage. Now, let's go back to what we were discussing before, APIs over HTTP. Now we know how an API can be identified using an HTTP URL, how the DNS resolver helps in resolving the server domain to a particular IP address, and then the client establishes a TCP connection with the server, and then magic happens. Now we'll use these fundamentals to understand more about two of the major APIs, REST and SOAP. Now REST is basically an architectural style of developing APIs over HTTP, while SOAP is a complete set of protocols with rules and specialized instructions. REST messages or the requests that you send to the server can be anything and is typically JSON, while SOAP API generally uses XML with strict typing and particular rules to frame the request as well. Finally, REST APIs or the services are stateless, while SOAP APIs can be stateful as well. Now we'll look into or understand what stateless means shortly in this video as well. But before that, let's try to understand how you can actually send a REST API request. So as we discussed, REST APIs is an architectural style and it uses HTTP for communications. That means that it uses the common HTTP operations get, post, put, delete to do whatever operations it wants to do with the API exposed. Now let's look at a REST API request in action. So we'll start with the GET operation and then we'll see POST as well. Now let's say the client is trying to fetch something from the API server. In this case, we'll call a GET request and we'll add some request headers. Now the request headers will have authorization details in order for the client to be authorized by the server to perform the fetch operation. It might have some custom headers as well. Now, since it's a GET request, we can directly add the fetch request in the HTTP URL params itself. Now, once the server processes the request, it will send back a response, and this response will have response headers, which will include custom headers along with cache-related information to help the client understand till what time this response is valid, along with the response code, which helps the client understand how this request was actually processed by the server. If it was successfully processed, the response will be 2xx or 200 OK in general. If it was a client error, for example, if the client wanted to fetch some resource that was not found, the server will send a 404 not found error. So 4xx errors are client errors. And if there was some issue on the server side, for example, there was a resource outage or the service was unavailable, the server will send a 5xx server error. And finally, the response will also have a response body, which has the information that the client wanted in a JSON format. Now that we understand how GET API requests work, let's try to understand or execute a POST API request. Now the POST API request will be similar to the GET request, except for a few differences. Now we'll have request headers that have the authorization details along with a new content type to specify what is the request content or what is the type of the content that I'm sending to the server. Then it will also have a request body with the actual request in a JSON format, which will be sent to the server. Now the server will then process it, send back a response. Though the response will be entirely similar to what we have seen in the GET response. So you have response headers, the response code signifying how the request was processed, and the response body in a JSON format as well. Now the response header might also have a content type field. I'm not really shown this explicitly in this header itself. Cool. Now that we understand what POST requests are and GET requests are, we are familiar with the world of REST APIs. So REST APIs uses HTTP for communication, it exposes a resource as an API, and it's stateless. We'll see what it means shortly in this video, and it can use any content type, preferably JSON. Now an API or a service that follows all these principles is called a RESTful service. And now we'll focus on understanding the drawbacks of using APIs with HTTP. So say you have a client and a server, and the client sends an HTTP request to the server. So the first thing that client will do is it will establish a TCP connection. It will then send and receive data over HTTP, and then it will close a connection. And for further HTTP requests, it will create another TCP connection and continue doing the same. Now this is one way a client can communicate with a server using HTTP. Alternatively, if the client wants to send or keep a persistent open connection with the server, it can do so by sending a keep alive header in the GET or POST request to the server. Now, once a persistent connection is established, the client does not need to open a new TCP connection for sending a new HTTP request. But this has one small problem. If suppose the server has some information and it wants to send to the client, it has no way to do so until the client explicitly asks for it. So with APIs over HTTP, the client has to constantly poll the server for new information. There is no way for the server to send out the information unless the client wants it. Now this is not suitable for chat applications, online gaming platforms, or video streaming where you need a persistent bi-directional connection. You don't want the client to constantly poll for new information. You want the information as and when the server has it. So for this, we'll now look into WebSockets. Now WebSockets uses TCP for establishing a connection with the server, and then it does something interesting. It uses HTTP to create or do a WebSocket handshake, and that where the web comes in, where you use HTTP to do a handshake with the server and upgrade the connection to a WebSocket connection. And after that, both the client and the server will have a bi-directional persistent connection where both of the party can share information as and when it needs to. Well, now this bi-directional persistent connection comes in handy when you want to develop, say, a chat application where you need the client and the server to communicate with each other and send requests as and when they have it, rather than the client constantly polling the server for information. Now, the URI for WebSocket is also similar to what we have seen for HTTP, where you have a WS and WSS endpoint rather than a HTTP and HTTPS endpoint. The rest of the things look similar to what we have seen for HTTP as well. Now, this is just an introduction to WebSocket APIs. We'll have a dedicated separate video where we'll implement WebSocket APIs in detail and we'll try to understand more concepts related to it. Now, let's have a look into some other API frameworks as well. Now, WebRTC is a framework for developing APIs where you need a peer-to-peer connection. And WebRTC is quite lightweight since it uses UDP rather than TCP. And we have talked about UDP in the previous video. So this is a really great protocol to use where you want to develop a real-time application where you need peer-to-peer connection. And you can probably use WebRTC rather than using WebSocket since this is quite lightweight also. Now, another interesting framework for developing APIs is the gRPC framework, which is used for building scalable and universal APIs. Now, this was open sourced by Google in 2015. Now, in this framework, each service will have a particular service contract, which will have the service information, the APIs it's exposing, and the request and response format. And clients can use this service contract to initiate a request to the server using a language independent stub. Now, the last framework we'll discuss is the GraphQL, which provides a structured query resolving API for gathering data and resources from multiple sources. Now, GraphQL client structures the query in a way to send out or ask for only those information that it needs right now. And the server will resolve the query from those sources that the client actually wants. And this is quite useful to bring down the latency as well. The clients don't have to make multiple HTTP requests to get the resources. It can make a single GraphQL query to the server. The server can then resolve the query and send back a single response with all the data that it needs. Now, one thing to note over here is that gRPC and GraphQL are really useful if you're using microservices. We'll talk about microservices in a separate video, but I just wanted to give an idea of the couple of APIs frameworks that we have as well. Now we can go back to understand how should we scale our APIs and services. We'll use the same server client model that we have seen so far, where you have the server that is exposing an API, which we call the service, and the client is requesting some service from the API exposed. Now, in general, the server will communicate with the database and will then send a response back to the client. Now, in general, depending on the type of request the client sends, the service can either persist the data in the database or fetch the data from the database. Now, we'll cover databases, memory, caching in a different video where we discuss fault tolerance and consistency protocols as well. But this picture overall provides a good overview of how a particular API is exposed and how the client interacts with it and how the service handles that request. Now, let's say your API got famous suddenly and you have multiple clients calling your API now. Your resource usage will spike. You will see increased CPU time and increased latency or database latency in general, and you might see increased usage of memory as well. What should you do? You might panic for some time and then you will increase your server or upgrade your server CPU and memory. Now, this is called vertical scaling, where you actually upgrade the resources your particular server has. But there is a limit to which you can actually upgrade your CPU and memory. And vertical scaling won't really help if your client base increases really fast. For this, we have to consider horizontal scaling, where we actually create multiple servers mimicking the original server that we have created. So each of the servers will expose the same API as a service that we have exposed earlier. And this is called as horizontal scaling. Now, you cannot really communicate with a particular server directly. You need some mediator or a load balancer in between. So every client will communicate with the load balancer first, and the load balancer is tasked with distributing the traffic across the servers. Now, let's understand load balancers in details first. Now, load balancers, as we discussed, are tasked with distributing traffic or distributing requests across multiple servers. Now, in order to do so, it uses some routing strategies, and we'll look into some of them. So we'll start with the static routing strategy, where the load balancer can actually distribute the traffic randomly or in a round-robin or sequential way. Alternatively, the load balancer can also dynamically route the traffic based on the resource usage or the QPS metric from the server. So the load balancer will try to make sure that the servers are not really overwhelmed, and this is where dynamic routing comes handy. Now, using QPS metric as a load balancing strategy for distributing requests across multiple servers might not be the best choice, since you cannot really assume the query cost of a particular query. So it's probably better to use resource usage metrics from the server to evenly and uniformly distribute requests across multiple servers. Now, the main job of the load balancer is to make sure that the servers are not overwhelmed, and this is probably the best metric that one can use. Now, let's say your servers are scattered across multiple data centers. For example, the first two servers in this case are probably in data center 1, while the third server is in data center 2. In this case, the load balancer can also use latency as a metric in order to distribute the request. For example, if you are actually calling from a location that is near to data center 2, the load balancer can redirect the traffic to the data center 2 server as well. Cool, we are now ready to understand what stateless services are. But before that, we need to understand what stateful services are. So we'll use the same client-server model that we have seen so far. And in this case, assume that the client is sending a request to the server, and the server preserves a state based on the request that it receives. Now it can use this state to form the response for the second request that the client sends. So this is an example of a stateful service, where the server maintains a state based on the request from the client, and it can later use this state for multiple purposes as well. But this has a major drawback. Let's say you have scaled your service horizontally to account for the user growth, and now the client cannot directly contact the server. It will rather contact a load balancer, which will distribute the traffic accordingly. Now, what if the first request from the client gets served by server 2, which maintains a state based on the request, and the next time the client sends a request to the server, everything is fine if the request is served by the second server. But what if the load balancer redirects the request to the third server? In this case, the server might respond with a 404 not found, because this doesn't really have the state that was sent by the first request. Now, this is the reason stateful services are hard to scale, and even if you do so, you need some complex strategy in the load balancer as well. Now, if the service was designed in such a way that there is no need for maintaining a state by the server, the request can be served by any server, since there is no need for maintaining a state. Now, this is the benefit of having a stateless service, because this is easier to scale as well, and you don't need any complex strategy in the load balancer as well. Now that we understand the benefits of having a stateless service, we now understand the benefits of having or implementing a REST API as well. The REST APIs are easier to implement and design and scale as well. Now we will discuss one more concept called idempotency or idempotent APIs. Now, idempotency is a property of a service or an API which ensures that if a client sends multiple requests with the same request body, the server should behave in a similar way. Now, to rephrase what I just said, if a client has already processed a request with a particular request body from the client, the server should not change or update the state of any resource if the client retries the request again or sends a similar request with the same request body again to the server. Now, this property of idempotency comes in handy, for example, when you are designing the like button API, which handles the number of likes that a user makes to a social media comment. Now, there are a couple of drawbacks with idempotent APIs as well, and we'll discuss this in the next video, where we discuss consistency among database replicas and consensus protocols. Cool. Now, that brings us to the end of this video. I hope you have liked something, and if you find this content interesting, do subscribe to my channel. See you in the next video. Bye.